All right, so my name is Julian Hagen. I'm an assistant professor in Utrecht, and Alejandro Serrano-Meno, who actually did all the work, is my PhD student. Yeah, that's how it is in the Netherlands. I'm not sure about other countries, but... So a bit about myself. I've been programming functionally since 1991. I started in the Scheme, so that was before most of you were born, I'm afraid. I started with Scheme and did that for a long, quite some time when I did my PhD and everything, and then I moved to Utrecht. And then my boss there, Deutsches Fiesta, said, well, you cannot program Scheme here. We don't have that many parentheses. So we want you to switch to Haskell ASAP. So I did. And of course, I know some do some non-FP languages if I need something practical, but that's okay. So I've run a large FP bachelor course in 2013-16, so I'm teaching second year students, 250 or 300 per year, how to do Haskell. And that's actually quite nice. I'm a lead maintainer of the Haskell Helium compiler, but like I said, I'm doing this in GHC. And for those here who think, well, nice, Haskell compiler technology, maybe that's a nice topic for a master, or maybe later a PhD. Well, we do have a compiler technology track in the Master of Computing Science, and it actually uses functional programming and Haskell throughout. And actually, the Paul is here. Is he still here, Paul? Paul is over there. He actually did the Masters. So if you want to know about it, ask him. He'll tell you to go somewhere else, I'm afraid, but... All right, so what's this about? Well, it's about static type systems. So what's a static type system? Well, the idea is that you build a type system into the language so that a lot of stupid, erroneous programs are forbidden. And this is, of course, a well-worn slogan, well-typed programs can't go wrong, for the right definition of wrong. But if a program compilation can go wrong, I think it's the duty of the compiler to tell me why. That might be me, but that's I think, that's his. Eh? And not many people who build compilers actually think they need to do this. But okay. So my field of interest, one of my major fields of interest is type error diagnosis. So what is that? Well, that's exactly the problem. I'm explaining to the programmer, okay, this is a program which is typing correct. Well, most people who build programming languages and type systems actually know how to do that. That's good. But I also want to know what kind of inconsistency was it detected. Is it a missing type class instance, or is it a unification error, whatever? It would also be nice if he tells me it's in this part of the program and not in these other parts. And then finally, maybe he can also tell me how it can be fixed. That would even be greater, right? Now, functional programming languages have many more places where you can make mistakes because of their higher orderness, right? If you compose functions with dot in Haskell, it's very easy to swap these things around, and then it says, well, this is not the output of this function is not equal to the input of that function, so you cannot compose them. In a first-order language, they don't show up, these problems. And I think that's the reason why, actually, if you look in the literature, most of the literature is actually about improving error diagnosis in functional languages. So another problem is languages follow Lehmann's law. So Lehmann said, well, whenever you have a system, and he only talked about operating systems, he said, well, they only become more complicated because people don't want features to be deleted, but they always want more features. So Java, for example, they added parametric polymorphism, so something like that, and genetics in 1.5, and then anonymous functions in 1.8 or 1.9, and it did not help the type error diagnosis. Haskell has grown a bit. Actually, the type error diagnosis of GHC itself is not bad at all, if you only use Haskell 2010. But if you go beyond that, you start to use type families, closed type families, open type families, GDTs, whatever, yeah, you sometimes get not so great error messages. So actually, I talked to Martin Oderski a lot about these things. Oderski is the guy who invented Scala. And he says, well, what I see a type wall, is that you have these type theorists that come up with all these more complicated ideas of getting more guarantees out of their programs, but when something is wrong, the compiler just says, ugh. Or worse, it says, not ugh, but it gives a completely different reason why it's actually wrong, right? The more complicated the type system, the more complicated will become the type error diagnosis. All right, so I give you a few examples here of things that could go wrong in Haskell. So the diagrams library was actually already suggested by a previous speaker. I don't see him at the moment, but maybe he's here. So the diagrams library is actually developed by Brent Yorgi, and it allows you to kind of build 3D and 2D pictures in Haskell as an embedded library. It's really great stuff. So this is an example where I take a square of size half, and I take a circle of diameter 1. I color them in the right color, so the foreground color of the square is navy, and the foreground color of the circle, I make it the dark goldenrod, whatever that is. And then I have an operator atop that puts them on top of each other. And that's the type of a top that I can do. So this says I take a diagram, I take another diagram, and I produce for you yet another diagram. But we see all these very complicated things here that I will not yet talk about. But these are type parameters. For example, the V says, in what vector space are you playing? Well, you cannot add a 2D vector space picture on top of a 3D vector space picture. It doesn't work. Yeah. So these are consistency checks that are enforced by the compiler. And this is the picture that you get when you play with that. Quite nice. All right, but what if you write a top true? Well, he says, well, a Boolean, because true is a Boolean, it's not a Q diagram, B, V, and M. Well, okay, that's actually still pretty reasonable, because what else should he say? But if I write, I have a 3D cube 3D, and I have this 2D plane, I put them on top of each other, then it says I cannot match type V2 with V3. And now, yeah, it would be nice if you would kind of explain, okay, well, V2 to me means it's a picture in 2 dimensions, and 3V is a picture in 3 dimensions. Maybe you can guess it at this point. But of course, there's lots of other things, like the B is a back-end description. You get things like SVG. Well, maybe a person doesn't know SVG, he's never heard of it. He knows maybe the other back-ends, but not SVG. And you say, what is SVG? It would be nice if you kind of explain this as part of the compilation process. Yeah, so I want to make these messages domain-specific. Of course, you cannot build this into the compiler from scratch, because Simon Peyton-Jones doesn't know what kind of EDSLs we will be building, right? And that V3 sometimes means three-dimensional vector spaces. So this is really domain-specific for a particular EDSL, embedded domain-specific library. Now, there's a few other cases that you can think of, missing instances. Maybe you can, when you miss an instance, you can say, I missed the instance, but maybe you can also tell the programmer where, how to get that instance. Because maybe he just needs to add deriving somewhere. And you can tell him. In this case, for example, we have a message that just points to where you can find the information to actually get this instance in your code. Another example here is with the formatting library that you get a type-safe printf in Haskell. So in this case, you get the now thing expects something of type t.builder, instead of a string, and I just give it a string because a list of characters is just a string. And now it turns out actually that it's very likely that the mistake that is actually the cause of this problem is the fact that a particular language pragma has not been turned on. Later, if I get to the demo, I can show you how that works. So it would be nice if the programmer can hint, hey, this is how you fix this problem, because it's very probable that you made this mistake. What you also often see is that if you use EDSLs, because you use a way of encoding your domain inside Haskell with its structural type system, it has a tendency to unfold all the type synonyms as much as possible to help you very much. So actually, in this case, there's only one mistake. There's only one character. See it coming back and forth? So this is an incorrect program, because this larger than, this wrangle there, is present. If I would delete it, then it would be type correct. And what I get is this huge error message telling me, okay, there's something wrong. Because it reveals the underlying implementation details of the domain-specific language. That's so nice. All right, and another good reason for using our stuff is that you can actually use it for other nifty things like this. You can say, well, you have a student who has to program with Monad because you actually want to have input and output, so they have to use the I/O Monad. Clear. You cannot write reasonable programs without the I/O Monad, some people will say. But before you teach them Monad, you don't want them to play with any other Monad in the world. That's risky. Yeah, people get hurt. I mean, if you have 300 students in your class, 10 of them will get hurt, believe me. Not many have died. No, that's okay. But, so what I want is that actually, if they would use the I/O monad, like in the top one, people are using the I/O monad, that's fine. That's okay. But if they use something in the maybe monad, they don't have their monad license yet. Right? So I can actually, with our technology, you can actually forbid programmers from using monads in all their generality and tell them, oh, right, this is actually why you're not allowed to write this kind of program. Okay, this was actually quite neat. Of course, this was not our intention. It just turns out that with what we had, we could do this, right? All right. So, what this talk is actually about is I have a PhD student, Alejandro Serrano Mena. He did lots of research. He built prototypes implementing outside-in X, that is the basis of Haskell's type inference, all by himself. And so that we could play with all of this in very general setting, giving very much flexibility. But then the question is, okay, nobody's going to use his prototype compiler because it doesn't generate any code, right? People do use DHC sometimes. So we would say, well, I was thinking, why don't we try to get as much of what we have developed, try to get it in GHC without changing GHC overly much, because Simon wakes up, we've ripped out all of his type inferencing and putting our own type inferencer in there. He's not going to be happy.
All right.
So what's a domain-specific language? I've seen the term EDSL come up beforehand, but I had no idea what everybody knows about it. So the idea of a domain-specific language is that it's a language specifically tailored to implementing code for a particular domain. And that domain has to be clear and well-defined. Its notation should be clear. Everybody should be able to understand, if you see a piece of code, hey, that's a regular expression. I know what it means, at least sort of, unless it's Perl. And this is important for us. What does it make it into a domain-specific language in a computer science way? There's a formal meaning that is clear and implemented. So I actually know what the semantics of a regular expression is. Again, with the exception of Perl regular expressions. So there's one thing missing. So this is true. I agree with him completely. But when you have an implemented formal meaning and it cannot communicate with the programmer in terms of that domain, he's lost. Right? We saw an example of this earlier. This is actually an example where I use parser combinators. But it doesn't talk about parsers at all. It just gives me a whole lot of types. Right? And that's it. So this is problematic, and this is what we aim to solve. Now, embedded domain-specific languages exist. The idea there is that you embed this domain-specific language in a general-purpose language like C++ or Ruby or Haskell. And actually, those are languages that actually are pretty good in doing this kind of thing, which is why I use their names. There are lots of advantages to this, but I'm not going to do that here. According to Paul Hudak, it's the ultimate abstraction. Yeah, that sounds impressive. So, Haskell, C++, also languages like Scheme, for example, are very well suited for this, and Ruby, but of course, they don't have any types. So they don't have the problem of type errors, because there are no type errors. Yeah, they just have non-working applications. I know companies that made a lot of money out of non-working applications. Now, do you pay for all the bug fixes? I'm not giving you any names, though. All right. So in Haskell and EDSL is just a library with a certain amount of fluency, as we call it. That's a very vague term, and you have to go to Martin Fowler if you want to complain. But and of course, it's related to fluent interfaces. Yeah, the Java's not so great attempt at being a language in which you can actually embed DSLs with relative ease. But the idea is that if I have a domain person with me, and I show him a piece of code in Haskell, and he doesn't know Haskell, he should still be able to understand the domain code. Maybe not the other stuff around it, but intuitively it should be clear to him, okay, I know what this is. And we all have this. If you see 2 × 3 in your code, this is the domain of arithmetic expressions. It's in every language, so we all know it. But in this case, I also want to have other domains in there, domains that are non-standard. Also, and now we get to what we actually have done to help solve this problem in the glorious Haskell compiler. So let's start out with a small program where this is the identity function for integers, int id, and what it does, it puts off the heavy lifting to the it prime function, which is just the identity function. So it expects an int to come out, because it's the integer identity function only. It's only to be used for integers. But what do? I pass it, I'm stupid, I pass in true, which is a boolean. This is typing correct, right? So what error message do you get with our GHC? This is what you get. All right? I came up with this example just around about where they had elections in a particular country. I'm not saying any names again. So this is the specification how you can get that to work. And this looks complicated, I agree. So first of all, here is the code. It says that our new function ID prime is actually the well-trusted identity function of Haskell that you get from the prelude. Good, but that's the code. This is the type. It says your new ID prime function is a function from A to B. Oh, that sounds very general. Ah, but that's because this stuff restricts it. It says it's A to B, but A has to be equal to B. And if, by chance, A is not equal to B, then this is the error message that I construct for you. And so this is just a different way of phrasing the unification problem that Haskell has to solve to make sure that this is the identity function. The nice thing is that I can attach a special error message to all the constraints that are failed to satisfy, that cannot be satisfied. Of course, if it turns out that A is equal to B, then you don't get this error message. Everything is just fine as it used to be. And in fact, the fact that I say ID prime equals ID here, that fact alone guarantees the soundness of my implementation. And that's really neat. I can let the type inferencer of Haskell prove that my error message adorned implementation of ID prime is actually consistent with the original ID. I can also get, if I want to, I could also get completeness. So maybe a few details for those interested. So this is just these diamond and these dollar here are just ways of, at the type level, put type error message strings together. So these are type level strings. Now all of a sudden, they're not expression level strings, but type level strings that I can glue together by means of this operator and that operator. This says put these two side by side, and this one says put this one on top of the other one. And that's all there's to it. This is all built into GHC. We did not invent this. This one says, A is not equal to B says, that whatever happens at this time, I already know that the type A and the type B can never correspond. If, for example, A happens to be bool and B happens to be int, and I know that, if the type inference knows that at this point, it says, it knows these will never become the same. We call this apartness. And this is a notion that is actually can be verified inside the GHC Haskell compiler. All right, so the nice thing I think here is that this ID prime is a type aware wrapper for this ID. So somebody can write an EDSL, and you as an afterthought, or maybe because you have a business in developing these kinds of things, you can wrap his library and only add the error diagnosis. So you can separate this out. Because not every EDSL developer, of course, knows everything there is to know about these type thingies. Yeah, so they can rent me or Alejandro to do this for them. And we're not cheap, I can tell you. Another thing is that we have texts here. Texts are also live at the type at expression level. Sometimes you need both, and that's why we need this e.text to distinguish the one text from the other text. But that's, of course, the texticality. All right, and this is one I'm really proud of. So one of the reasons why this is so neat, I think, is that we can use type-level abstraction. So we can have type-level functions like VS, that you give it two types, A and B. So at type inference time, this is not A and not B. It might be that because of inference, A is actually already an int, and maybe B is a bool. And then it will tell me, it will say, okay, whenever I get to this part, I will just look at this type A and B. I will show these types for you, and I will put them side by side, maybe with some kind of string like VS in between. So why is this neat? Why is this neat? Because, of course, throughout all the error messages that I want to write for all the functions that I have in my libraries, I often want to say, this type versus that type is not correct. And then it would be nice if all of these calls would be kind of look the same. Right? So I can do that because I can just say, oh, I write a wrapper. a type level function, VS, that will just write it down in the way that I want. And whenever I always use VS from wherever I write my new rules, then they will all look the same. And if I change it, then they will all look the same again. And I think that's neat. So I'm using stuff from GHC here, which is already present. All right, so what is difficult often to get your head around here is that this is an inequality check, as it were, right? It's, of course, I can delete the slash here, and it looks like a unification. But it should not be a unification. These checks should not have an effect. I only want to see, if I look at this constraint, do I already know that it will never be fulfillable? Yeah? So that's a partness. So if I know, for example, that I have int on the one hand and int on the other hand, well, then they're the same. So they will never actually become different. If I know that the one is an a and the other is an int, well, it's still possible that some other part of the program will narrow down the type of a to bool, but it's also possible that it later becomes an int. I don't know yet. But I also know, for sure at this point, that I don't know yet that they are different. That I don't know that they are apart. However, if I look at the type of A and B here, and I see that they are different, int or bool, for example, then I know they can never become the same again. Types can only be instantiated. So if I have int and bool, then I know that they are apart, and I know that if I look at this particular constraint, and this is an int and that is a bool, then I know that I may generate that message, that sound. But if it happens to be the case, for example, that this one side is a function from A to B and the other one is bool to list of A, it could still happen that these become the same. Because these are both function types, A could still become bool and then B has to become a list of bool, but there is a scenario in which they become the same. So they're not apart. But these two types can never be reconciled, so they are apart. And actually what we did is we made this apartness check syntactically part of GHC. We just put it somewhere, roped it here in the constraint failure, so actually we can deal with the failure of unification errors, and we can deal with the fact that a type class constraint that originates from your piece of code, and you cannot find an instance for it, these are called left undischarged constraints. Yeah, for these kinds of constraints, you can come up with your own error diagnosis to explain why they occur. And then a custom error is simply a constraint failure together with the error message that you want to generate. And sometimes you have constraints for which you don't want to have an error message, so we just say we check them. And so there's a special case where the message is that use the default message. So for our atop example, this is what you would get. You say, well, I have atop is a function from Q diagram to Q diagram to Q diagram with all the corresponding backends, vector spaces, blah, blah, blah. Now, first of all, I rip out these types, D1, D2, these are my two diagrams, and I return something of type D1. And then I say, okay, but this only is correct if D1 is actually a Q diagram. So if you discover that D1 is not a Q diagram, then you are free to generate this error message. And then you can actually say, look, argument number one to a top must be a diagram. So you can talk in domain terms now, because you are in control of the error message that you're generating. And of course, it would be helpful if I would also tell you, but this is the type that I did get. Of course, you can do that. Yeah? But this is just to keep it a bit simpler for this. And you do the same for the other ones. D2 has to be a Q diagram too, blah, blah. Then I check, because these introduce new type variables, B1, B2, V1, V2. It has to also check that this backend is the same as that backend. So this is this check. And then I can talk about backends. And I can talk about vector spaces not being the same. And explain whatever I want. It's up to me, as an EDSL developer, to decide this is the information that I want my programmers to get. All right. So this is an example of these abstraction facilities that I get from GHC. This is, looks like a function, but it's actually a type. It's a type-level function that I give the name of what I check, the two types that I compare, and then I say, okay, this thing, if I find that they are different, they are apart, then I say, okay, this thing that you gave me, which could be vector spaces, which could be backends, whatever kind of type, I can say that they don't do not coincide, and then give you the type of A and the type of B. So you can rewrite your top definition like this. You can say, first I'm going to check, are the arguments Q diagrams in the first place? And these are independent checks. Whether the first one is a Q diagram and the second one is a Q diagram usually does not have any influence. So I can check both. And if both of them are not Q diagrams, I get two error messages, which I think is nice. Only if they're both Q diagrams, then I will look at these four other constraints here, verifying that they have the same backend, the same vector space, the same numerical fields, the same query annotations. And the nice thing is that I can use this do not coincide type function to make sure that the messages that you actually get in your screen actually look alike. They have the same template. And then finally, I check, but give no special error messages for all the type class predicates that arise. Now these are, I think this is already quite nice, but there's more tricks you can play with this. So we started experimenting a little bit with this. So what often happens is that you have something like this. You have diagrams that actually tries to be very type safe. So to us, a pair like 3,5, to us it's both a point and a vector. If you're a mathematician, you don't distinguish between the two because the context will make that clear. But if you are a Haskell programmer, you need your types to give structure to your world, otherwise you die. What? Now, if I have 3,5, I can, and actually diagram sees that I think as a point, but not as a vector. So you cannot ask for the perpendicular of 3,5, while a mathematician would find it very normal to ask for the perpendicular of 3,5. But what it does actually, it has a special type for vectors to distinguish it from ordinary point types. And of course, there is a conversion function that will take you from a point, a tuple, to a vector. But you have to be explicit. So wouldn't it be nice if you find out that a function like perp, which stands for perpendicular, if it gets a pair like 3,5, that it can actually suggest, look, you have to apply a conversion function R2 to turn your pair 3,5 into a vector, and then I understand what you mean. Right, and of course there's syntax for that, but I think I have only one minute, so that's not going to happen, but you can of course come talk to me later if you think this is interesting. We have special syntax that can kind of allows you to check, but I don't get a V2A, but if I get a tuple, this is the message I get. If I don't get a tuple, you get the default error message that I want to give. And this is also supported. So I don't have time to kind of give a small demo. So we did all of this in GHC. You need a lot of dangerous language extensions, but you as a programmer or as an EDSL developer even don't need to see them. We had to see them, or actually Alejandro had to see them and understand them. I have no idea what they mean, but that's fine, as long as he does. We worked out quite a number of these rules for some of these libraries here, like persistent and formatting. There's a lot of other stuff we did. Again, I don't have time. And actually, Alejandro's presenting this work this week at the Implementation and Application of Functional Languages conference in Bristol. And I want to leave you with your slogan. So the idea of the whole thing, if you want to take away anything, first of all, domain-specific type error diagnosis is possible. Don't let them fool you or tell them otherwise in Haskell. It's even possible in GHC. But the core idea is that we get expression-level type error diagnosis. So if I write a type-incorrect expression, I can use type-level programming to get better error diagnosis for those cases. Thank you.